name is Arlen Heginbotham. I'm a conservator here at the J. Paul Getty Museum. We're in the South Pavilion, and today we're going to have a special visit with our 18th century French gilt-bronze compound microscope, a wonder of technology in the 18th century. We're going to look at our microscope in this room, which was designed and built around 1750. So we're really in the environment that this microscope would have been used in. The case has a lot of little latches. It's a spectacular case. The leather upholstery with its beautiful gold tooling would have been made by a bookbinder, and the locks would have been made by a specialist locksmith. The interior would have been lined with silk velvet and gold braid trim. It's an incredible object on its own. This microscope is really very highly refined scientific instrument. It's in high Rococo style and gilded bronze. It has shark skin covering the tube. Everything made by the top artisans and craftsmen of the day. The first thing I'll do to demonstrate is remove the lens cap. We have an ocular lens right inside here. We have a secondary lens in the tube here and an objective lens here. This case also has a drawer which contains a lot of the fittings and extra equipment, and a little hidden drawer behind which contains some of our specimens, extra lenses, and extra tools. I'm going to place a sample from about 1800 into the sample stage. Today we're going to look at a flea. There's a mirror underneath here. It's a concave mirror, so it collects light. I'm going to point it at the window, and then I'm going to adjust the position of it until the light is coming directly up into the lens and I can get the best possible view. And then a fine focus knob here to get it absolutely perfect. We have five objective lenses. Those are interchangeable. Each one of these lenses is made of two pieces of gilded bronze that hold a tiny little individual hand-ground lens that was perfectly prepared. So now I'll put the number four lens in. And now you can see I can really zoom in just on that little flea's head and see all of his whiskers. One of the great innovations about this microscope is its ability to measure things that are very, very small. For that, we use this micrometer. So I can move this needle right up to the flea's eye. And I can measure the flea's eye by noting where the dial stops. And then as I drive it in to the other side of the eye, I can see how many units I've moved it and make a calculation for how large the eye of the flea is. So I'm gonna switch the sample here and take a look at a butterfly wing. Pick up that little piece of it with these gilt bronze forceps, which I can insert into the microscope stage here. Now a butterfly wing is not transparent, so shining light up from the bottom doesn't really help me. So what I need is this very special Lieberkühn mirror. And that's designed so that when the light comes in underneath from the mirror, it's going to hit the polished concave surface and shine light back down onto our sample. And now when we look through the lens, we can see the butterfly's wing, and we can see these beautiful scales that make up the surface. All of these samples are from the 18th century, sandwiched between glass. And they display all of the different kinds of things that people were interested in looking at the time. This is what science was like in the 18th century. They were fascinated by things that were too small to see with your eye, and with a microscope like this, suddenly the incredible precision of nature at this ultra-fine scale became apparent, and it was marvelous.